These are extraordinary times that we're going through right now, going through a severe crisis, and there is a way to get through this, no question about it. And we will do that. In the midst of the crisis, always have this belief that you know there is a way, and it's different than the world tells you about. Very, very, very different. You see, we're only dreaming that we have harmed reality, that we've done some harm to what is real. We believe that we've killed reality, and yet reality keeps coming back to life, so we have to kill it over and over and over and over again, and we're trying to find some way to make that death permanent. The truth is that we haven't harmed reality in the slightest bit. We're only dreaming that we harmed it. Yet the dream seems very real. We see the dead body there, and we think, oh my gosh, you know, how terrible. Now, if we are trying to wake up from this dream, the waking up will seem to take the form that we are trying to heal this dead body, trying to bring it back to life. It's in intensive care, and we're trying to get its heart started, and we're trying to get it out of the coma and all this. And then we finally succeed, and we say, oh my gosh, incredible, incredible recovery. We've been able to bring it back to life. And then we go through a phase where we suddenly say, wait a minute, I was only dreaming that this life was struck down and dead and in a hospital and trying to be resurrected and brought back to life. All that was only a fantasy that I was having. And in fact, this life has never been harmed in the slightest bit. And that then brings you to a point where you can reconcile and then be aware of this life within you. It's there. The guru is within. The life is within. Divinity is within all of us. And it's important that we become aware of it within us. More important than externally. You know, some guru externally, we think, oh, the life is out there. No, it's within us. We just think that it's dead, that we killed it. And we go through the cycle of trying to make this death permanent. So it seems to come back to life, and we have to kill it again and again and again and again. We have all this guilt. We project guilt onto others. Everything that's happening in the world is just manipulation of guilt. We all have this guilt complex, and the manipulators of guilt will tell us that we can get rid of this guilt by getting rid of those bad guys. Those are the ones over there, our enemies, the ones, they're the guilty party. Let's project our guilt on them, and then we get rid of that. And so you have all these politics going on and conflicts in the world manipulating guilt. We think we can finally get rid of this guilty feeling we have. No, we get rid of the guilty feeling that we have by realizing that it was all a dream and we never caused any harm to reality at all. So within us, there is this completely awake, completely alive, completely perfect, flawless, invulnerable life within us that's never been harmed. And we are in the process of realizing that we were just dreaming that we harmed it. And so we're kind of afraid to, you know, say hello to it and say, because we think that it's got all these scars, you know, and it's all on life support, and it doesn't trust us because we harmed it, you know. Not true. We never harmed it. Dreams don't harm reality. Fantasy does not harm reality. Hypotheticals don't harm reality, don't affect it in any way. And the more we can realize this, the more we can catch ourselves and say, wait a minute. I can be in the presence of this life within. It's not mad at me. It's not angry. It's just trying to wake me up and realize that there was no harm. We haven't been able to harm it. So that's the homecoming that we're looking for. That is what gets us past this crisis. It frees us from the crisis. The crisis in the world is really taking place within a dream, within fantasy, within a hypothetical. It's not affecting reality in any way. However, it can drastically reinforce our delusions. So the real threat in the world is that our delusions are becoming reinforced, and that is a serious threat. It's a threat to our sanity. It's a delaying tactic. It doesn't threaten reality at all, but it does prolong our misery and fear and guilt and suffering and all this horrible nightmare of a dream. It prolongs it. It makes us reinvest in it. And that is something that we want to avoid at all costs, because it really, nightmares are no fun at all. And so here we are here in this channel, these videos, getting past this crisis by recognition that we never did anything to reality. We dreamed it all up. The trauma, we dreamed it all up. The body being hit by a truck, the body lying in the road, the body being unconscious, the body being neglected, the body finding desperately rushing into the hospital, the doctors frantically working on it. We're outside so worried, is it gonna, you know, we killed this body, we killed this life. And this whole trauma that we're going through, trying to get it back to life. And finally we find out, yes, it came back to life, and the life has been saved. And we're waiting to maybe go see the patient, you know, and we're all nervous. Fact is that this life, we all dreamed that, we fantasized it, we hallucinated it. It was never struck down, never. It's just been waiting for us to realize this. So the homecoming is a happy homecoming. We don't have any guilt. If we didn't ever strike it down, where's the guilt? There is no guilt. Okay. And the world is full of guilt manipulators, and they rely on their own, they rely on your believing in guilt so that they can manipulate you for their own aggrandizement. Okay, so there is this very strong push in the world to turn away from truth. And every time that truth gets spoken in this world, it's surrounded by those who would try and fragment it and dissipate it. That's what I have seen. It's a very, our dream is a fragile situation. Our guilt, our fear, our dream. We're not sure if we can come in and see be in the presence of this, of the life that is within, because again we think that it holds some grudge against us, and we haven't atoned for our harm against it. You know. No. See, that is the fragility of the situation. We have done nothing to reality, nothing at all, not even a scratch. In our feverish imaginings, frantic imaginings, have only caused this fear and guilt, but it hasn't caused anything in reality at all. It's only a hypothetical, plausible. Guilt is just plausible. Fear is only plausible. In reality, there's no fear, no guilt. So it's just within this hypothetical scenario of our imagination, we imagine that we're experiencing all this suffering and fear and drama and trauma, and yet we haven't harmed reality at all. So there is no demand of us that we atone for anything. Why should that which has never been harmed atone for anything? We just dreamed we could harm ourselves. We dream we could harm reality. There's been no harm. So there is a reconciliation process taking place where we realize this. That's what I feel within myself. That's exactly what's happening. The realization that the life is alive. It's within. There's just a thin barrier. I just need to come out of my room and go and see that life, you know. And the realization that, no, there's never been any harm. It's kind of a dawning of this realization that takes place in all of us. That's what has to take place. The more we're oriented toward this, the more we push away the guilt manipulators and this whole dream. And we say, no, not interested in that. That's a false path. for a while, we will keep dreaming that we're rescuing and bringing this life back to life. But at a certain point, we say, wait a minute, that was only a dream, that I was just imagining this. That's what's just, you know, when you fall into a dream, you're not aware of reality, right? So we it's been so vividly real to us that the body, the dead body, and having to, you know, try and resuscitate it, the dead life, trying to resuscitate the dead life, the deadness within us, the guilt we have, all this. It's just, again, a complete hallucination, a complete dream. And there's a point where we realize this and say, oh my gosh, there was never any harm whatsoever to what I am, to reality, to life. Never any harm to life. Life has never been harmed in any way. Never. And so it's not mad at us. It's not angry. It doesn't fear us. And it's very poised. You know, it's just calm, poised, happy, delightful, and perfectly aware, perfectly alive, not harmed in any way. And then we come into the presence of this, and we just feel that, and we just say, wow. And there's a point where we get over the belief that somehow we cured it of anything, right? We brought it back to life. No, we did not. We didn't cure it of anything. We didn't bring it back to life. It was all a dream. It's never been dead. So you get to this crossover point, you know, where you see, wait a minute, was this all a dream? Did it really happen or not? And you evaluate this, and you kind of go, whoa, okay, maybe it was this all a dream, you know. And then the dream, you gradually say, yeah, never happened. Never really happened at all, none of it. And so you realize that, you know, there wasn't any process to bring life back to life. There was no process to resuscitate life. There was no emergency care for life. There was no accident for life. There was no trauma for life. Life didn't suffer any trauma. And we didn't see the trauma. And we're not the heroes that brought life back to life. We're not. There are no heroes. None. Zero. Was never traumatized. It was never harmed in any way. It was never in any hospital. It was never resuscitated. It was never brought back to life. It was never nursed back to life. It's not in a fragile condition now. None of that is true. So as we speak about this, at a certain level, we realize this is true, but at deeper levels, the guilt is still, you know, the guilt is still there, the trauma is there, the efforts, all that's still there. However, we can bring this clarity to that dream, okay, and say, wait a minute, maybe this was all a dream and nothing happened to life ever. We can do that. So it's kind of like there's this dichotomy going on, where we kind of saying, I think this is maybe true, and yet there's all this belief that we've been going through, this trauma, and we need to bring them together and make a decision and say, wait a minute, this was probably simply my own imagining. Nothing ever happened. I imagined the trauma to all this, and I've been believing all of that. And so I'm believing it, I believe I've been experiencing all of it. It's just all belief. All that it's been is just belief. And you have to bring that to the belief in the dream. And so at some point you have to do that, because before you can be in the presence of your own self, your own of life that you are, you have to resolve this. This has to get resolved. Otherwise you're going to kind of be too nervous and thinking, you know, that how can I relate, because I'm the one who brought this back to life, and you know, where's the gratitude for that, and where's the evidence of all the scars and the trauma, and how can we prevent this in the future? It's awkward. So before you can really be in the presence of your true self, the one true self, life itself, this has to be resolved. You have to be able to bring that to the dream, to the belief, and say, wait a minute. Let's go with this. Let's go with this. And then that the dream will dissipate. The dream dissipating simply means you accept and recognize and accept, there never was any trauma. There never was any accident. There never was any death. There never was any emergency procedures. You never took this dead body to a hospital. There was never any doctors working on it. There was never any emergency procedures, and there was never any resuscitation. There was never any nursing back to life. There was never any rehabilitation. All of that was just my dream of what I believed was happening. But the fact was, this life has always been there, completely untouched by this, just waiting for this realization, for you to bring this realization to the belief, to the dream, to the belief in the dream, and to say, no, this is all just a fantasy. That is what it all means. Awakening from the dream, that is what it means. So if you can see what it means, it's a lot easier. Bring this truth to your belief in the dream. Just say, hey, this is what I believe is true. And insist this, but don't, there's no fight. You just say, quietly say, hey, wait a minute. I believe that this is true. Okay, so no worries. And let that lead, let that truth lead. So you come out of your room into the open air where the I am is, and just then be happy in that presence, be blissful in that presence. The relief, relief is there. Oh, tremendous relief. Nothing ever happened to I am presence, to reality. Nothing ever happened at all. It's all a dream. It's all a feverish imagination. And then why? Of course, because we wanted to be Prime Creator, so we had to dream this dream of trying to find a way to force Prime Creator to change reality for us. And then we tried to figure out a way to threaten Prime Creator. So we tried to figure out a way to kill a reality, a power of death over reality. So we dreamed that we had this power to kill reality. The only problem is reality kept sensing it's still there. It's like coming back to life. So we had to keep killing it over and over and over again. And we're trying to find some way to make the death permanent. Okay. But that's all a dream. That's all a fantasy. It's all a hypothetical scenario. We wanted to then use this power to force the Prime Creator to change reality. It would be a threat. We'd say, okay, we know we have a way to kill reality permanently. And you have to change it or we'll do that. But all of this has simply been a dream. All this killing over and over and over. All this trauma. Nothing's ever happened to reality. Nothing at all has ever happened to reality. It's untouched by that. Was never touched by it. Was never threatened by it. So we bring this truth to our belief in that it did happen. So we have a belief that all this has been real. And we have to say, no, it was only our imagination. And there's kind of this point you reach where you're like, you're not quite sure, which is true. So I had this whole dream last night exactly of all this, and I woke up and I started thinking about the dream, and I said, well, wait a minute, now this was all a dream. It never really happened. The whole accident, all this stuff never really happened. I only imagined. I was just dreaming that it happened. So this is an example that you can catch your belief and say, wait a minute, belief, this is just a belief that all this happened. It didn't really happen. And then consider this and say, hey, wow, yeah, maybe this is so. And then clarity and truth gets the ascendant, becomes ascendant. And you lose your fear of being in the presence because you never caused it any harm. It's not some ancient enemy that you've been attacking for billions of years, for eons. It's not some ancient adversary that you've been trying to overcome. None of that is true. You've been only imagining this adversary condition, this ancient enemy. It's all been a dream. We've just been making it all up, 100% made up. So, as you focus on this central dynamic of awakening from the dream, really, you are less vulnerable to being manipulated, having your guilt manipulated by the world. Those who arise to, you know, great positions of prominence in the world, the external secular world, are just the external world, the dream, are expert manipulators of guilt. That's what they do. That's why they get so much influence, is because everybody wants to escape this guilt, this terrible feeling we have. We've done something horrible. And they tell us, oh yeah, I know the way to escape guilt. Here's how you do it. You blame those people over there. They're the bad ones. They need to be destroyed. They need to be crushed. And people say, oh wow, okay, that'll free from guilt. And the guilt manipulators say, yeah, that's how it's done. See, that's entirely different than awakening from the dream. You escape your guilt by realizing there's no cause or foundation for it whatsoever. That's how you escape it. So as you focus on this, I've been saying that these videos are designed to help get through this crisis, get past this crisis, sidestep the crisis, get free of it. And that is true, because by awakening from the dream, you realize you don't have any guilt, and therefore you cannot be manipulated through guilt. You cannot be manipulated. All the stuff in the dream cannot manipulate you anymore. And you allow then I Am presence to deal with the dream, to do what's necessary, all right, which is perfectly capable of doing. It's totally competent. Whereas all this dream is not competent. It's vulnerable to manipulation. So if we're asking, well, how do we get to be safe, and how do we all this stuff? The I Am presence knows all of that. It knows it's all a dream, but it also sees in the dream, okay, here's where, you know, it's most beneficial to be, and this is what's most beneficial to do to help the awakening, okay? And if there are those who are not willing to awaken, they say, okay, let those be for a while. It's perfectly intelligent, perfectly capable. You know, it is the true guru. It is the true guru. The true guru is within you. The true guru. Even greater than Ramana or Nanamayama or Jesus or Buddha or whatever, is the guru within you. Even greater. Because you will have direct awareness of its presence at all times. It will be there. It is there. You know. It's with you. You know, whereas these external gurus, they come and they go, and they tell you, you know, that find the guru within. That is true. Find the guru within. And that's what we're doing here. And you'll be more blessed than even being in the presence of some, you know, famous guru. More blessed. Way more blessed. That is the truth. And there is a way to do that. And that is what we're doing. There's definitely a way to do that, and we're right on the cusp of it right now. Awaken from the dream. Awaken from this dream by just saying, hey, wait a minute, bring your clarity to your belief in the dream, that the dream is real, and say, wait a minute, no, none of this was real. I was only imagining it. None of it was real. I was only imagining it, including the heroic part. That's the most important thing, is that we didn't save anything. We're not, the dream is not a savior of anything. Okay, we didn't rescue the I Am presence. We didn't rescue that. We didn't save it. We didn't heal it. There's no need for any healing or saving or rescuing at all. So giving up that is the all-important part. because we want to cling to our dream and think, no, we're the hero, we did something great, and we think that is going to be the answer. It's not, because that's still saying that the I Am Presence was vulnerable. We did attack it, we did kill it, and yet, but we're good, and we did the right thing, and we healed it. No, that doesn't awaken from the dream. That just reinforces the dream, reinforces it. So awakening from the dream is a very different thing than being a hero in the dream. Very different thing. Entirely different. You have lots of heroes, those who believe they're heroes in the dream, who think they've done something great. But their situation is very different than the ones who have awakened from the dream and realized that they did nothing. And they didn't need to do anything. I need do nothing. That is the truth. None of us need to do anything at all, except to awaken from, and so that brings the awakening from the dream. Nothing needed to happen in the dream. Nothing. No healing, no resurrection, no convalescence, no nursing, no treatments, no saving, no rescuing. None of that, none of that has ever happened or needs to happen at all. We're just dreaming of this, imagining it. And the testimony of, there's been testimony throughout the ages that we can awaken from this dream. Absolute testimony that we can do that. So I believe that entirely, we can do it. Bring truth to your belief that the dream is real. Bring truth to all facets of the dream. You didn't do anything bad, you didn't do anything good. Both sides, that's duality. Duality is belief in good and bad. Bad and good. Okay. So you awakening from the dream doesn't mean you awaken from part of it. Like you awaken from the bad part and say, no, I didn't do anything bad, but I did all this good stuff. I healed the, you know. You can't have a hero in the dream unless you believe in the first part of the dream that you successfully attacked reality, right? Because if you want to heal anything, you have to believe that something was harmed in the first place, right? So the two sides of one coin, the coin goes, it's just one coin, and we keep on emphasizing this very small narrow area because it's that which will free you from this world crisis. World is in crisis. Should be very evident. And the dream is becoming very nasty. Very nasty. Alarmingly so, shockingly so. To those who want to awaken, shockingly so. The pressure is on. Because the dream is all about now finding out who's guilty and who's going to be the heroes of the dream, and a vicious fight over all that, because everyone's trying to escape this guilt and trying to be the hero of the dream. In order to do that, they have to, you know, supplant other heroes and say, no, you're not hero, we are. You're the guilty one. You're the one who tried to kill, you're the one who killed reality. We're the ones who brought it back to life, or we're the good ones, you're the bad ones. There's this extreme tussle going on. And the awakeners are those who say, no, none of that is true. There was no bad guys. There were no good guys. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. None of that dream was necessary. It was all 100% a dream, imagination. All equally untrue. Equally untrue. All the healers, equally untrue to all the killers. Equally untrue. There were no killers. There were no healers. I Am Presence needs none of that dream. Doesn't need the dream of being nursed back to health. Doesn't need the dream of convalescence. Doesn't need the dream of being fed the right foods. Doesn't need the dream of us singing nice songs. Doesn't need the dream of us chanting mantras to it to bring it back to life. Doesn't need the dream of our meditation to heal it. Doesn't need the dream of any of that stuff at all. It's just sitting there in perfect condition, as it's always been, just waiting for us to awaken from this dream and realize it doesn't need any of that. doesn't need for us to get the bad guys, punish the bad guys who killed it, who harmed it, who attacked it, get rid of the attackers. Doesn't need us to purge the world of the attackers, you know, make a utopia, get rid of all those bad guys who were killing reality. And of course, that's what all the self-righteous heroes believe they're doing. They're getting rid of the bad guys, killing them off. So doesn't need that. Doesn't need any heroes. Doesn't need any warriors for truth. Doesn't need any warriors to try and wipe out those who are the bad guys in the dream. No. It just needs us to awaken from this dream of good and bad, of heroes and villains, of healers and sickness, of trauma and trauma centers. Yeah. Again, the whole gamut of the dream, including all our spiritual practices, our meditations, our contemplations, our mantras, our chanting, our affirmations, all of this stuff, the entire gamut of the dream, awakened from all of that is totally unnecessary. The I Am Presence, which is what we are, was never harmed in any way, was never in any danger, was never in any threat. It's always been in perfect condition. Doesn't need our mantras, doesn't need our meditation, doesn't need any of that stuff to somehow help bring it back to life, to bring it back to peak condition. No, it's all a dream. All of that is a dream. The end of the dream is simply to come into the presence of the I Am Presence and realize it was never harmed in the first place. Come to that realization that maybe that it will be a gradual dawning, like, hey, maybe the dream will just gradually kind of just dissipate like a soft cloud cover in the morning. Just you look up and you realize, oh, the sky is blue now. Maybe there's a few wispy clouds here and there. Kind of like that. Every day in the Bay Area, it's like that now. The morning cloud cover, and gradually it just dissipates. And you look up, you know, there's just a few striations of clouds, a few clouds here and there. But the blue sky is all around now. You see the sun, everything's, you know, clearing up. It's like that. It's a gradual thing, saying, ah, wow. The whole thing was just a dream. The good, the bad, the ugly was just a dream. All my heroic efforts weren't necessary. But because I thought they were necessary, I went through it all to get to a point where I thought that the I Am Presence is now healed, it's now in a good condition, I can now at least talk with it. And then at that point you say, now wait a minute, maybe it was all a dream. So we don't want to discourage entirely your efforts to heal and all that stuff. But as you're doing that, in the back of your mind, you need to say, wait a minute, you know, probably this is all just a dream. All right? Because ultimately, even all the healing and the mantras and the meditation, that is still a dream. You haven't awakened from the dream through all of that. All of that does not awaken from the dream. It just is trying to build up our nerve to peek, take a peek at the I Am Presence and see how it's doing in its convalescence. You know, but we're kind of afraid to peek. And yet, as we peek and look at it, that's our imagining too. If we see it like it's convalescing, we're only imagining that too. Any condition that we see the I Am Presence other than its perfect flawlessness, oh, timeless flawlessness, isn't our imagining. Because we look at it and see a convalescing body or some, you know, something convalescing or something that is, you know, going through its rehabilitation, something that's pretty much healed up. That's still our imagination. That's still a dream. Still a dream. We're superimposing that like a screen. We're not aware of the actual I Am Presence. The actual I Am Presence, I've been aware of it a few times, just glimpsing. And then I kind of say, what was that? You know, what was that? Wow. Huh? Wow. Is that true? Is that true? And I said, wait a minute. Then what's all this dream and rehabilitation stuff going on in the belief system? And then trying to say, which is true? Which is true? You know, wow. But in the times that I have had glimpsed it, wow, it's like flawless, you know, perfect flawless. There's no sickness there. There's never been any trauma at all, none. And so then we wonder, well, what is this whole effort then to get well. What is that all about? No, it's perfect wellness is already present within us. Everything else is just a dream of our own, of our imagining. Mind is imagining all this because we wanted to force Prime Creator to change reality for us. That's the basis of all this nightmare. And of course, we can just give that up, choose a different idea, and say, "No, I don't want to try to change reality. I don't want to be Prime Creator. I want to accept what is as it is. Not try to find some way to threaten Prime Creator to change it." Okay, that's the whole basis for all this. And once you realize that, then there's this awakening from the dream where you get to the point and you say, maybe this was all a dream. The good and the bad and the ugly, all of it. The rehabilitation, all of it. The meditation, all of it. Everything I tried to do, you know, the heroic actions which I've taken, all of that was just a dream. I could, at any point, I could have awoken from the dream and say, none of this is necessary. And so you might ask, well, what does this have to do with, you know, the dream? Well, it has to do with awakening from it and realizing it was none of it was necessary. It has to do with getting free of guilt, free of trauma, free of fear, free of suffering, free of misery. It has all of that. It has to do with that. And the dream is becoming so full of turmoil. And for many, it seems to be full of opportunities because those who have been labeled the bad guys are now seeing they can become, label themselves as the heroes. Heroes and villains are changing roles, you know. So it seems to be opportunity. Whereas if you have believed yourself to be a hero in the dream, suddenly you realize you are now being seen as a villain. And you say, no, wait a minute. I thought I was the hero. And so, you know, this dream is heroes and villains, you know, is the dream. And the roles keep flip-flopping, and the guilt keeps being projected, you know, the heroes project the guilt onto the villains. And then the villains are struggling to get out from that guilt, and then the way they do it is then they flip-flop and they make it redefine everything, and then now they're the heroes, and the guilt rests on the new villains. And it just goes around and around, and it's vicious. It's really vicious. So this flip-flopping has been taking place, and I'm aware of it. Because I was in the role of a hero, of the hero of the dream, and now I see I'm being inexorably put into the role of the villain of the dream, guilty. You know, the guilty party. All the guilt's being projected on the type of situation that I, the role in the dream that I've been part of, a white male in America, you know, we are the guilty ones. We're responsible for all the bad stuff in the world. That's exactly what's been placed upon us. So I looked at that and I said, no, wait a minute. There's something messed up with this. I said, I know I'm not, there's something within me that is not guilty of all this stuff. So I said, no, wait a minute. But that's exactly what's happening. You know, before it was, you know, the white man was the savior, you know, the hero of the dream. And now that's all being flip-flop, and now the white man is the villain of the dream. Okay? The guilty ones, the one that all the guilt should rest upon, and the one that should be punished for being, causing all the suffering throughout history, and should be torn to pieces and crucified. And we can talk about that if we want to, but it might get more, might bring up a lot of upset because there's been a lot of very nasty business going on as far as the dream goes, betrayal, all sorts of stuff that everyone's trying to save their own skin. Nobody wants to go down with the ship. So everybody's kind of agreed in the world. Let's all agree at this point that it's just the white man that is, they're the bad guys. And the white woman's okay. Yeah, because she agrees the white man's the bad one. And all the third world's people, all the rest of the world saying, yeah, it's all the white men, they're the bad ones. Okay. And they've all agreed on that. So the poor white man is without any allies right now. So it's not a mistake or happenstance, etc., that this awakening from the dream is happening to come from someone who has a white man's suit on, monkey suit on. Because that is where, you know, the whole pivot of the whole dream continuing on is taking place. Whereas if the white men accept this guilt, then that just reinforces the whole dream. And the whole thing perpetuates itself very severely. And the white man is, you know, in the crosshairs of this dream right now. So the I Am Presence bringing this truth into the world and sharing it here chose to use a white monkey suit, white man monkey suit, United States, you know, to share this, give this sharing of awakening from the dream, so that the entire dream, the potency of it can be lessened. It's very important. Because white men should not accept this guilt. They should awaken from the dream. Everyone should awaken from the dream. If they accept it and say, yeah, you know, a lot of them have accepted it. And they want, they're very self-destructive right now. Very self-destructive. They all want to die to try to atone for this guilt, you know. They want to bring destruction down on their heads. So they're pursuing a very self-destructive path. And there are others who are saying, no, wait a minute, you know, this is all bogus, you know. It's all bogus. And there's also this frantic, you know, social engineering and guilt engineering of the dream going on. But the crux of it is to awaken from the dream. Because again, none of the dream is real. All of it, good, the bad, the ugly. If we merely keep flip-flopping the hero and villain's role, we've gotten nowhere. Nowhere. So everyone in the dream should reject guilt entirely and say, all this has just been a dream. Nothing has happened in reality whatsoever. And all of the stuff that the trauma that's been happening, we've been simply imagining it all, inventing it, because we're trying to find a way to kill reality. So everyone who played the victim role, everyone who played the victimizer role, all of that was in cahoots. It was all a collaboration, all of it. All victimization is a collaboration, has been. It is all an attempt to manufacture this way to kill reality and keep it killed, keep it dead. And because we haven't succeeded at this, everything keeps, you know, the roles keep changing. Musical chairs in this dream is musical chairs. So if you ask, have I accepted the white man's guilt, the white man's beard? No, absolutely not. It's totally bogus. Its roots are roots of insanity, of ignorance, the dream. It's the dynamic of the dream that is insisting that we accept this. No, the burden that we all have is to awaken from the dream. And realize the I Am Presence has never been harmed in any way. Nothing's ever happened to it. Nothing ever can happen to it. And we have simply been trying to manufacture this power over reality. And this whole dream has all been in cahoots, collaboration. Everything in the dream was collaborative. All roles. Coming from one source, from the mind, presenting this idea that we want to try and experience, trying to be prime creator. So the good, the bad, good, the bad, the ugly, all cahoots, one role. So everybody that has died at the hand of another, they die. It's been orchestrated. The whole thing is an orchestration. And again, it's had no effect on reality, so there's no basis for guilt. You know, it's like dust. Throwing dust around. We've just been throwing dust around. You know, where's the guilt? Have we attacked life? No. Have we harmed life? No. Has life ever been harmed? No. But we've been pretending. Ah, I'm dying, I'm dying, I'm suffering, I've been torn to pieces. Ah, you know, the body, you know, has been attacked, attacked. The body is just a device that we're using. Our suffering is all imagined. It's all our imagination. It's all a dream. It's all our dreaming. In a dream, there's all sorts of figures. All sorts of stuff's happening to the figures. When we awaken from the dream, we realize, whoa, nothing ever happened to the dreamer. I am the dreamer, and nothing ever happened to me at all. Nothing. But we... So... When I see all this, you know, flip-flopping of roles, you know, just so... Not good, not right. Don't believe in any of it. But on the same hand, I'm not rushing out there, you know, being some sort of political activist saying, social activist saying, you guys are bad, terrible, you're wrong, blah, blah, blah. Because that doesn't help anyone awaken for the dream. It doesn't. It really doesn't. It's just like people are, you know, trying to hold on to their hero role. But that itself is causing the problem. Okay. See, I was brought up in the tradition of the high, the noblesse oblige, sort of the high Christianity, charity, love to all, helping the world, you know, all this super high idealism, you know, hero, the hero role of the dream, have to be the one that helps all the suffering and misery of the world. See, but now that's the role that's been, is now under attack. And all that, you know, religion is under attack, Christianity is under attack, all that, those ideals are under severe attack. They're now being seen as the villains of history. They're the villains, they're the back, they're the ones who caused all the problems. And so, being aware, you know, of all of this stuff, I just observed it, just examined it, just being observation. Seeing, okay, so this is how this dream, the dream works. You can see how the dream works. Dream works, you might call it dream works. So, and you realize if you cling to that, you're going to go down with the ship. You really will. You got to get past it all. And I've been able to do that to a very large extent. I'm still not dwelling in the I Am presence. But I can see it's very doable, very possible, very likely. Entirely likely, you can put it that way, entirely likely that I will do that. There's no, you know, the dynamics are there for that to happen. It's there for everybody to happen. We just have to do it, to awaken from it, and to keep on focusing on what we need to focus on. And we don't need to defend anything, okay? Don't need to defend anything. We don't need to get into all this talk of, well, now we, you know, who did what in history? Nothing ever happened in history. Nothing's ever happened. In a dream, does anything ever really happen? No. Nothing is really happening. Nothing ever really happened. And we never need to make anything really happen in the dream. Doesn't matter. You just need to awaken from the dream. At that point, you won't accept any guilt at all upon your presence. You will not project any guilt upon your presence. You won't accept it. You won't project it. You'll be free of it. And you'll help others be free of it. But truly, the heroes are going down. The whole heroic role is flip-flopping. So if you cling to that ship, you're going to go down with the ship. So I'm not attacking anything, you know, in the dream. I'm saying it's all, I'm just putting in the right context and perspective. So even all the religions and teachings and all the idealism, all of that, that's part of the dream too, 100%. So if you cling to that, you say, no, I'm a good person, I'm an ideal person, I'm going to save the world, I want to, et cetera, I want to be, you know, one of the heroes. What will happen to you is you will end up projecting guilt onto others, seeing the villains, and you will betray. You will forsake. You will forsake many, and you will, the ones you used to be aligned with, you will now see them as your enemies, there, and project the guilt upon them, so you can remain a hero. That's how it's done. So those who you used to be your dear friends, and you now see them as, oh my gosh, they're really wicked. And you will align yourself with the new heroes who will insist that you forsake all what you used to be aligned with. And now you will condemn all of that. You will condemn, you know, Christianity. You will condemn religion. You will condemn all that idealism. You will condemn the white man. You will condemn this Western civilization, modern. You'll condemn all that. You'll say, no, that was all completely wicked, and that all needs to be wiped from the face of the earth. And we have a new set of heroes, and you align with a new set of heroes. And the whole charade will simply continue, which is simply history. That is history. That is how it works, actually. And those who will, you know, holding fast to the idealism that they believe it makes them the hero, they will find themselves now being seen as the scum of the earth, as the sudras, those who simply pick up the trash, those who simply, they will get the lowest jobs possible. They will be scorned. You know, sudras are those who, you know, untouchables. You'll become an untouchable in the dream. That's what I've seen. So that's guaranteed, that's a fact. So you either sell out, betray your friends, and align with the new heroes, and condemn, and be willing to crucify those who you once were closest to, or you will go down with the ship and become an untouchable sudra, or you awaken from the dream. Those are the options. Those are the options. I refuse to sell out and betray and accept the guilt and all that, so I find myself now like a sudra, an untouchable, unable to, you know, have any position at all in the whole heroic hierarchy of the dream. But I don't want that sudra position either. It's funny. People see me, other sudras see me, and they say, what in the heck are you doing here? This is not right for you. I mean, that's crazy. You are not a sudra. You are not one of us. I say, yeah, that is true. That is true. Really, I work among the sudras, you know, doing all the dirtiest, nastiest work. And they just say, look at me and say, you're not one of us. What are you doing here? Because, you know, I refuse to accept the guilt. I said, this whole thing is not right. So this whole sudra trip is a temporary thing. I was assessing the whole dream. How does it work? Now I know what's going on. And I know that awakening from the dream is possible. So basically I'm going to go from a sudra to an awakened one, you know, awakened one in the presence. Which is probably how it usually works, I would think. Because usually it's when the hero role flip-flops. And what you used to think that you're a hero. I mean, I used to think, yeah. I mean, the level of culture that I identified with, that my persona and everything was identified with, was the heroic, you know, the pinnacle of heroicness, the ones who were going to save the world. And when that, you lose that and you realize you're going to be cast down into the sudra status, you say, no, wait a minute. I don't think so. I don't want this. I don't really want that. And then you start really applying yourself to awakening from the dream. And you may find yourself cast down for a while, which I have, and you work even harder to awaken from the dream. And then you awaken, and then you're not a sudrist anymore. You know, Jesus, what was his ministry with this, a lot of the sudra people, right? The untouchables, kind of the cast-offs of society. He wasn't going around into the Sanhedrin and all these high righteous, idealistic people? No. Because they're not interested in awakening from the dream. They're interested in being the heroes of the dream. But that's not awakening from it. That's what prevents the awakening. Because that is asserting the reality of the attack. Say, yes, there's been a terrible attack, but we're the heroes. We're going to heal reality. That's not awakening from the dream. So Jesus went around and he collected all these, you know, misfits. People would say, what is this guy doing talking to these untouchables? You know, shouldn't be talking to them at all. Because some of these untouchables are ones who are actually very highly motivated to awaken from the dream. Because at one point they were the heroes, and now they're the villains. And they're saying, well, I don't want this. What do I need to do to awaken? And Jesus would say, well, this is what you need to do. And then Jesus says, share this information with us. But again, the I Am Presence is within us, each one of us. The I Am Presence that was within Jesus is within us. Same I Am Presence. Invulnerable, flawless, perfect. It's within us. It's not a person. It's a presence. It can seem to personify itself, relate to us, because we're still hooked on this dream of persons. But it's really this presence, the living light. The living light is within us. We are that living light. That is our true identity. And we're in this process of waking up to this and realizing, yes, this is true. And this whole dream was a dream, much ado about nothing, as Shakespeare put it. Shakespeare was someone who was awakening from the dream, or had awakened. Certainly in the process, certainly there in this awakening, dawning of truth. Much ado about nothing. That is existence. Much ado about nothing. And yet, full of sound and fury, you know, signifying nothing. Very true. Heroes and villains. Both roles completely delusional. So by Dayama Sudra, you know, filthy clothes and dust and, you know, subject to all this terrible stuff, and then I shed that, you know, and do these videos, kind of thing. What in the world's going on here? It didn't used to be a sudra, you know. How did that happen? Well, I know how it happened, because I've been observing it, just in state of observation, observing the entire thing, how it happens. It all is intentional. It all is the dynamics of this dream. And bit by step, by step, by step, leverage, 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 leverage. Those who are on top get thrown down to the bottom. And this churning of this pit, this nightmare dream, is like a deep pit. And it's constantly churning, like crabs going up, climbing up. They get up, then they're pulled down. And other crabs are pulling them down, and they're climbing up on top of them. They get pulled down. Never-ending process of heroes and villains, constantly shifting roles like this, you know. And when you're been a hero of the dream, you don't want to be cast down to a villain. That's when you have a strong opportunity to take the spiritual path of awakening from the dream. Whereas those who have been villains and they see that they're going to be heroes, why do they want to awaken from the dream? They don't. They say, no, I don't want to awaken. I'm going to be the hero of the dream. What more could I want? So you have this teaching of awakening from the dream, and a lot of those who are going to become heroes of the dream are trying to suppress it, trying to misinterpret it, give a spin to it, that we're supposed to be worshiping the new heroes of the dream. That's what all this teaching, they say this teaching, like they, for instance, they'll say, the purpose of men, white men specifically, is to worship women. You know, they'll tell you something like that. Because women are the new heroes of the dream. So they say, yeah, that's your new role in the dream. So as you fall down from the hero role, you have the new heroes dictating to you, assigning roles to you in the dream, is what's happening. And for me, I said, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to. So what role do I get? Sudra role. See, if you're willing to worship the new heroes of the dream, maybe you don't get a sudra role, or at least you get a, you know, a butler role or something. It's not so, you know, you get to manage the help. But if you refuse that, you end up, you know, you end up cleaning the stables. Or you end up awakening from the dream. See, that's how it works. So, here we're awakening from the dream. We're not telling you you're supposed to worship the new heroes of the dream. Okay, no. You're not supposed to hate on them either. You're not supposed to attack them or anything. You are supposed to clarify. You know, it's, you know, they will say that if you don't worship them, then you're attacking them because you're not accepting their authority to assign roles to you. Okay, that, of course they will say that, and they'll try to lay a guilt trip on you, of course. Because power in the dream is the power to lay guilt trips on others and force them to serve you and force them to acknowledge that you are, you know, you are the new hero, you are the new savior, and do their bidding. And if you don't, they say you're trying to project guilt upon them because they don't understand the awakening from the dream part at all. So you just have to, they say no, don't accept that. Their projections of guilt upon you and say that you're attacking them. Not true. You're awakening from the dream. You're showing them the way to get free of this horrible nightmare. Okay, you cannot accept those type of projections. Seeing how the dream works is not attacking the dream. It's seeing that you don't need the dream. It's a difference, big difference. But they won't see it that way. They'll say, no, you're trying to thwart them from being the new heroes. We're saying that don't fall for this. You know, as you, the dream is pushing you up into a heroic role. Don't accept it. And they think, oh, you want me to continue to be a servant, huh, or a villain? No. I want you to awaken from the dream. Because if you accept the hero role, you are going to waste a lot of time. And you'll go through a whole nother cycle, and at some point then you will be pushed down into the villain role again. And as you're playing this hero role, you'll think, well, I don't need to awaken from the dream. You know, why? I'll lose this heroic being a hero. So you'll fight any notion of awakening from the dream, thinking you're going to lose something very valuable. So those who are ascending to the new heroic role, a lot of women, a lot of third world people, everyone who's supposedly been in the villain role, or the lesser, the role, the servant role, that's flip-flopping, and now they're on the ascendancy. They see this teaching of awakening from the dream as somehow trying to limit them and keep them so-called oppressed in the villain role, which is simply not true. But they have been spinning it that way. Most teachers in this world who are speaking the truth have they've been surrounded by the new heroes, those on the ascendancy, and they're spinning it. They're spinning it to distract you away from the clear teaching of awakening from the dream, which is why you have not been getting the clarity that you need, the clarity, because it's being spun by all these, you know, I don't want to use any names, because that gets then they'll interpret it as being attacking, you know, attack. But you know what I'm talking about. Those who are on the ascendancy, the new heroes, okay, of the dream, they seem to be very much spiritual and into all these spiritual teachers, all that stuff. They're just making sure that that awakening is not being taught. They're just making sure that they're spinning it from all those who are going to worship them, that nobody hears what's really being said, but what they interpret it. They say, this is how you should interpret it. Remember, authority in the dream is to assign roles to everyone and say, this is what you must do. You must worship the new heroes. This is how you have to interpret everything. So they, by exercising their power, they're saying to everyone, this is how you have to interpret this teaching. Okay, you can bring a true teaching in, and then they will say, no, this is your role in relating to this teaching. And they twist it into a role of worshiping them, of thinking they're the ones, they're the great ones, they're the heroes. Not true at all. Okay, that's just a dream. That's perpetuating the dream. You don't have to worship them at all. You have the I Am presence within you. The living light is within you, within everyone. And you can awaken to that by awakening from the dream. So you see these very powerful new heroes of the dream. Most of them women, okay? They're the new heroes of the dream. And a lot of them third world type women too. They're the new superheroes of the dream. And they're interpreting for everybody, trying to tell everybody what they should, how they should think, what roles they're supposed to have, all this kind of stuff. And ultimately the role that they're telling us, we're supposed to be worshiping them because there are new saviors. Again, there's no need for any salvation whatsoever. There's only need for us to awaken from the dream. There's no need for any atonement at all. There's no need for any reparations. There's no need for any paybacks. There's no need for worshiping anybody in the dream. None of that. That only reinforces the dream. It only reinforces it. But what the only need is to realize that none of this was necessary. We made it all up. The good, the bad, and the ugly. We simply imagine it all. And nothing ever happened to the I Am Presence. Nothing. Not even the tiniest change ever happened to it. We just dreamed it up. I'm teaching here. I don't have any followers. I don't have any entourage. I have nothing. I don't really want anything, because as soon as you go out in the world, you get all those who are the heroes of the dream. They flock around you, and they then use you as a symbol to legitimize their supremacy in the dream, that they're the new saviors of the dream. That's what I've seen. I don't want that. Don't want that at all. I want to avoid that. So you don't see this satsang, all these people, you know, coming to me at this point. I don't know in the future how it's going to play out. But it's not something that I'm, you know, interested in at all. Because what I see is I see teachers who seem to be teaching about, you know, awakening from the dream. And they get surrounded like by all these people who want to be heroes of the dream. And then they simply use the teacher to legitimize their authority in the dream. And what they really want is they want themselves to be worshipped as the heroes of the dream. All those devotees who come to the teachers, that's what they really want. Very few actually want to awaken from the dream. That's what I've seen. There are some. There are some, male and female, both. There are plenty of women, females, who don't want to become the new heroes of the dream because they see through the scam. They see through it. They say, no. Been there, done that. Okay, because in ancient times, the matriarchy was totally ascendant for a long time, and the males were simply slaves. They had their roles assigned to them by the matriarchy. What they could think, what they could do, everything assigned to them. And the matriarchy was totally all-powerful. They were the authority of the dream. And then that gradually got turned around the last several thousand years. For a brief time, then the patriarchy seemed to be the ones assigning the roles, and now that's flip-flopping, and the matriarchy is coming back to be the one, the new hero savior in the dream. But there are plenty of men and women who say, whoa, been there, done that, don't want that. That's a trick. That's a trick to hook me into the dream again, and I know that that's horrible waste of time. So it's a fiction that there's some, you know, great movement of women, that all women want this ascendancy of the matriarchy and they want to be worshipped as the goddesses. That's a fiction. It's not true. There are many, many who don't want that. They say, no way, don't want it. But they're being cowed, you know, intimidated to go along with this. And they're having a guilt trip laid on them that somehow they're betraying the sisterhood. You know, that they're traitors and they're going to be put down as sudras if they don't follow along with this whole flip-flopping of hero and villain roles in the dream. So there's a lot of pressure on everybody. So it's not a uniform thing. There I've seen both men and women want to awaken from the dream. Okay, some. But by and large, I've seen that the women going to gurus, they want to get the authority of the guru so that they can be worshipped. They want to be the heroes of the dream. And they, the men coming to it, are simply trying to figure out how they can get on the good side of these new of women, the new heroes of the dream. How can they not be cast down into the sudras untouchable status? So they're trying to, you know, appease and try to find out, you know, oh yeah, I need to be in touch with my feelings. I need to be in touch with the matriarchy, with the feminine, with the divine mother, all this kind of stuff. They're desperately kowtowing, brown nosing to the whole thing. It's, you know, and I don't blame them. I'm not judging. I'm just saying that's what's happening. I just say, you know, hey, why not awaken from the dream? Why not awaken from it? See, so that's the dynamic I see in all the satsangs and all the spiritual teaching of the world, that there's a handful of those that do want to awaken, and then the majority is just they're desperately trying to find the best roles for this, when this flip-flopping has already happened. And so the new heroes of the dream, they want to be worshipped, and they want all the authority to assign roles to everyone else. Like they're the new aristocracy, and everybody else is desperately trying to be, you know, trying to find some roles, courtiers, you know, trying to find something that's not so terrible. And so the men are bowing and scraping, you know, and kowtowing and frightened out of their minds, you know, say, my gosh, I hope they don't see me as one of those terrible oppressive males, you know. And if they, you know, oh, they're doing everything, I mean, that they're, you know, they'd be willing to wear skirts, you know, if it kept them from being thrown down into the lowest ranks of a sudra, untouchable, you know, cleaning out the toilets. Really, that's the roles that if they don't, that's what they'll get. I do all that stuff, all the worst stuff, and that doesn't even bother me anymore. Just, you know, doesn't touch me. But really, that's the whole farce that's taking place. You know, so I see it very clearly. That's always the case. There's always a handful of those who want to awaken, always. And the majority are always just trying desperately. Some are trying to solidify their position at the top, and others are desperately trying to get on the good side of the new rulers of the dream, as a, you know, the new heroes of the dream. Desperately. But if you've already been cast down into the untouchables and already done all this horrible stuff, you know, the grunge work, you know, the stuff that the untouchables do. I mean, the untouchables in India, oh my gosh, you know, they take care of all the dead animals and dead bodies, really. They clean all the toilets, they do all the cleaning, all the toilets and all the dead bodies, the dead animals, the dead humans, everything. They have to deal with all of that. All the garbage, deal with all the garbage. Okay, all of that. You've already been there, kind of done that. Then you say, you know, hey, not really afraid of being cast down anymore. So then you can say, now wait a minute. How about awakening from the dream? I'm not going to be kowtowing to the new heroes of the dream. I'm not going to be worshiping them. I'm not going to buy into that. You know, I'm not going to have the new matriarchy say the purpose, the men's purpose in the world is to worship women, and that fulfills their purpose. Men will be then fulfilled and happy by that. Worshipping the new heroes of the dream. That's what they're saying. That's what men are being told. And that's, men are desperately trying to figure out how to worship women. Desperate, you know. You know, what do women want? And they want to be worshipped. And how to do that. And they're frantically studying and watching movies and TV shows and going to seminars. And, you know, how can we worship women? How do we do it? How do we do it? We're not quite sure how to do this. And then they have all these new age, you know, gurus, pundits explaining how to do it. All this stuff is—it's—it's. If it weren't so tragic, it would be hilarious. But tragic in terms of wasting time, much ado about nothing, not awakening from the dream. So for those handful of those who really do want to awaken from the dream, these videos are for you. This sharing is for you. And will continue to be. And you get the feeling, say, hey, no, it's not attacking the dream. It's just saying there's nothing of any value in the dream. That's different than attacking it. It's, there's nothing. It's all unnecessary. It's all a fantasy. Set it all down at the same time, you see. Don't don't cling to the hero role either. The whole thing, the suit untouchable role, the hero role, it's all equally unnecessary. Nobody needs to be healed. I am present doesn't need to be healed. Doesn't need to be saved. There's no atonement necessary. No reparations need to be done. No sacrifices need to take place. No atonements again. No payments. We don't have to atone for the heroes are being cast down now. They think they've done bad. They failed. And now they have to atone for their horrible failure. See, the dream doesn't work. It's a failure. We never keep reality dead. We never keep death dead. All right. We keep killing death, keeps dying, but we can't keep it dead. And so eventually we realize, those managers who are doing in charge, they failed. Let's get a new management. Let's fire everybody. New CEO, new management team. Let's bring it in. You know, it's happening all over the culture now. Put the matriarchy in charge. Put the women in charge. Even, you know, training the soldiers. Put them in charge. Everything. Put them in charge. They put their management class in charge. And they say, let's find out a way to keep death dead, which is what the purpose of this dream is. So those who think they fail, they think, oh, I've got to atone, I've got to pay the price, you know, in suffering for my failure. I'm a miserable failure, a wretched failure. I wasted everyone's time. I caused all this suffering was in vain. I'm to blame. I'm guilty for it. And the only way I can get rid of this guilt for this is I need to serve the new masters and, you know, carry out and die for them, sacrifice for them, take care of all the death, do all the dirty work, and maybe, you know, and help them succeed because I'm a failure. Of course, everyone's a failure. The dream is a failure. Can't keep death dead. We cannot keep death dead because we're imagining it all. How can we keep what we're imagining dead? We keep imagining it. Because every time we turn towards truth, it's still there. We say, oh my gosh, it's still not dead. We didn't keep it dead. It must have resurrected at some point. We glimpse it in the I Am Presence. It's still there. We say, ah, doggone it, it must have resurrected. We failed to keep it dead. So we need a new management class. You know, thousands of years in the future, it'll be the bring back the patriarchy. Right now, it's bring back the matriarchy. Put those in charge. They know how to keep it dead. They're real stern taskmasters, and they'll keep it dead for sure. They know how to crack the whip. You know, punish those lazy, shiftless patriarchy who didn't get it done. Grind them under their heels, you know, because they were lazy. They didn't get it done. Yeah, so every time we check in and take a peek at the I Am Presence, is it dead yet? You know, no, it's not dead. Doggone it. We don't realize that it was never dead. Okay, we just think it was resurrected. And we say, oh, doggone it, we didn't keep it dead. We failed to keep it dead. So now we go back to work. So let me go over this, because in my experience, I've already experienced this. You get a glimpse of the I Am Presence. It's there. It's flawless. And then you say, oh, let me assess this. And then what happens is you kind of think, wait a minute. I thought it was dead, but it's alive. So you think, I better work on keeping it dead. Somehow it springs back to life. And then you keep buy into the dream of how can I need to make death dead permanently. And so you keep working at trauma, make it worse and worse. You get another glimpse. It's alive again. You say, oh, it resurrected again. You get another glimpse. And after a while, you start thinking, I wonder if it never died. So it's not a matter of it was dead and got resurrected. It was never died in the first place. Maybe this whole thing of death was just a dream. Then that puts you on different footing, entirely different footing. So when you get a glimpse of I Am Presence, you don't say, oh, it resurrected. I better go back to work and say, no, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Maybe this whole dream was a dream of death, was never touched it in the first place. It's always been perfectly alive, never resurrected from the dead. That puts you on an entirely different standing with the dream, with your motivation, entirely. You see, your consideration now is very different. Say, no, wait a minute. maybe it never resurrected. Maybe all this time when I caught a glimpse of it and thought, uh-oh, it resurrected, and I went back to work on making death permanent. Maybe that was all a mistake. Misinterpretation. I misinterpreted what I saw. I misinterpreted. It wasn't a resurrection. It was the fact that this dream never touched it in the first place. Okay? So you see, you can put yourself on an entirely different footing than previously. Entirely. All right? It's not a joke. Don't have, you know, pinch yourself. You're not dreaming. It's not a joke. It's an entirely different standing now, footing, foundation. Your foundation is different now. It is that you say, wait a minute, maybe it was never dead in the first place. So there wasn't, I wasn't looking at a resurrected self at all. Okay? I can't kill the self at all. Even can't even harm it at all. So I don't need to go back in the dream and try to keep working on some way to make it dead. I don't need to worship the matriarchy now, either as a man or a woman. And I don't need to do that because I don't need to find some way to keep it permanently dead, because it was never dead in the first place. And again, I said there are a lot of women who don't want to worship the matriarchy. A lot. They say, They say, this is a trick. This is a trick. And the wisdom is within them, too. It's within all of us. It's within all of us, both men and women. There's plenty of us who don't want to go along with this whole thing. You know, say that this is a trap, and it is, it is. And it's also a trap to try and just play it both ways. You know, that's a trap too. The way is to realize it. The I Am presence was never killed in the first place, so there's no resurrection. It's always been perfectly alive, and every time that we glimpsed it, it wasn't a matter of that it somehow had sprung back to life. No. It's always been alive. And so we gradually get to this point. We say, we don't need to work within the context of the dream anymore, of this so-called healing thing. This so-called healing thing is perpetuating the myth that it was dead in the first place. Okay, it's a trick. It's a trick. We don't have to be the heroes of the dream are just draped in this facade of they're the healers. What they really are, they're the ones who are signing roles to try and make death permanent. That's actually what they're after. It's all this ideals and healing and stuff is a window dressing. It's a facade to try and kind of soften the blow, you know, of what they're really trying to do, what the dream is trying to do. Again, everything that arises in this dream are just stick figures. No one's to blame. There's no real beings, people, or not beings, all these entities that arise are just figments of imagination. So there's no blame. The blame is on spirit choosing this crazy idea, and that's the remedy is to choose a different idea. That's all. The remedy is to awaken from the dream, not to blame anyone, any figment of the dream for anything, but seeing the dynamic of the dream as a whole helps you awaken from it. Okay. We don't need to attack, name names, or blame anyone in the dream. There's just these broad-based, you know, flip-flopping of hero and villain, constantly flip-flopping and assigning of roles and attempt. It's all an attempt to make death permanent. And yet, how can you make something permanent that's never there in the first place? It's folly, right? You have to laugh. The truth is that the healers are merely studying pathology. They think they're studying, you know, as they're healing, they're trying to say, okay, where's all these vulnerable points? As they're trying to get something well, they're also saying, okay, so this is how it got sick, so this is where the vulnerable point is, and they're observing all that so that later they can bring even a more severe trauma on the situation. That is the truth. That is really the truth. If you look at the world carefully, you will see that the healers are actually very intent on studying vulnerability. Okay. If you're really wise, you realize that this is all a dream. Why do you need to study vulnerability? You need to awaken from the dream. So healers, again, are actually playing a research role in trying to find out where the vulnerability is so that the attack, future attacks, can be more on point, more vicious, more traumatic, and that eventually we can find a way to make death permanent. That is the truth. Even all these people, oh, I'm healing with music. I'm healing with sound. I'm healing with color. I'm healing with fragrance. I'm healing with chanting. All this stuff presupposes that there's some vulnerability. There's some trauma there. There's something that's out of alignment. There's something that needs to be brought back in alignment. All of that is simply a dream. There's nothing out of alignment in reality. Nothing. There's no vulnerability in reality. There's no need for any, you know, color therapy or music therapy or eat certain foods or any, all these therapies, all these therapists are actually very, very acutely aware of certain vulnerabilities of these dream figures and how these can, this can be exploited potentially, you see. And they're cataloging all this data of these are the vulnerabilities. And then, oops, they're data gets compromised and the bad guys get a hold of it, and then the bad guys now can go out and attack more successfully. That is what happens. So the good guys are getting all this data and they say, oh no, do no evil, we're good. And they say, and later on they say, oh my gosh, the bad guys got into our data and now they have all this stuff on you. It's exactly how it works. It's exactly how it works. So don't worry about trying to be some healer or therapist. Forget it. Awaken from the dream. You can do it. Reality was never harmed in the first place, never died. It never died. Nothing real ever died. Ever. Nothing real was ever harmed. Nothing real has been out of alignment. Nothing that is real needs any therapy at all. And you can see this. You can experience it. As you awaken from the dream and realize you made it all up. All this vulnerability, you dreamed it up. It's just a dream. You just believed in this dream. Mind is presenting the dream. You're believing in it. Is what it is. That's a good way of looking at it. We don't want to get trapped in who's I and what's all this kind of stuff. Forget all that. Just awaken from the dream. Just realize that reality never resurrected. The I Am Presence didn't resurrect. It didn't get healed through some therapy. It doesn't have any points of vulnerability. It's not out of whack. It doesn't have any complexes. Nothing is needed. Simply be in the presence of the I Am Presence. Accept it. And don't say, uh-oh, I better leave now because I might be hurting its therapy. You know, it's vulnerable. It's fragile. It's fragile. No, what is fragile is our dream. When we feel this fragility, it's the belief that any of this dream is true is fragile. And that is what is dissipating. The fragility is dissipating. It's not coming from the I Am Presence. But we're kind of a little bit confused about that. So this period, there's uncertainty, and what any teacher does, it helps with this uncertainty, this kind of crossover time of uncertainty, like, where's this fragility, you know, should I let it go, or what's going on? And there's always some in the world, always, that want to awaken, really want to awaken. Now, how far they've gone in clearing up this confusion, it differs in every case. You know, a few may have done a lot of work. Many may have kind of not done so much, you know, so that the confusion is still pretty strong. Because this whole flip-flopping, you know, hero and villain catches people by surprise. And they keep thinking, wait a minute, maybe I can slot myself, you know, somewhere in the middle here and not really, you know. And that, so they don't go on the spiritual path where I said, no, I'm not going to accept any of this guilt at all. So I realize I can't find any place to be slotted in the middle. I'm going to go down to the bottom. And then I did. I've gone down to the bottom and I said, I don't really want that. I don't want the guilt either. I know that's false. So that causes an intense spiritual path to take place. Whereas if you're just trying to kind of get along and slot yourself in the middle, appease the new regime, you know, that kind of stuff, you won't really get with the spiritual path intensely. You'll have it as an option, you know, kind of on the back burner, because you say, things could get really bad for me. I better at least, you know, maybe go towards waking up. Maybe. Have I found a lot of the others in the Sudra class like myself? No, I have not. I haven't found any, really. So most people are trying to appease to some extent. But a lot of people who don't want to appease, don't want to accept the guilt and say this is wrong. They're falling through the cracks right now, a lot of them. They're losing everything. And they're rapidly falling down to the untouchable classes, rapidly. I just fell super fast, you know, because I said, no, I'm not going to play this game of the dream. No way. But there are those who have integrity, and they say, wait a minute, this whole thing is crazy. It's all a scam. It's all a guilt trip. It's not true. It's not right. You know, and they felt they could slot themselves somewhere, and now they find themselves plummeting, free-falling, you know, because they're not going to worship the new heroes, and they're going to find themselves dispossessed of everything. And so they're experiencing it now. So their desire for awakening from the dream is suddenly get intense, you know, very intense, which is why I've anticipated that's going to get very intense. But it's not that easy to do it all, you know, boom, at once. So I don't know, you know, how it's going to play out. But again, even some help is better than none. Three legs up is better than none. At least they can get a sense, like, you know what, even though I find myself falling down into the untouchable classes, dispossessed of becoming the scum of existence, I do see that there's a way to get free of all that. I do see it. And that will be a powerful thing that remains with them. So I think full steam ahead right now. Full steam ahead. Because I have been going through a crisis, no question about it. Really a terrible crisis, my gosh. Last night I was dreaming just all night long. In the dream I was just sobbing, inconsolable, crying, just inconsolably crying. So long, horrible, you know. But then again, applying truth to the belief in the dream has brought me, you know, out of that situation, you know, suddenly see, wow, it's entirely possible to dissipate this confusion and simply be in the presence of the I Am Presence, allow the I Am Presence to be as it is. It's absolutely possible. And those of you who are feeling yourself in free fall, you know, there is this net, you know, there is this safety net, there is a net of clarification that can soften the whole thing for you. And you say, wait a minute, maybe I don't have to accept all this guilt. At the same time, I don't have to fall away. I can awaken from the dream. I can make that as my goal, is awakening from the dream. It is very possible. I am seeing very clearly how it's super, super possible, inevitable. Simply have to clarify, that is it. The I Am Presence is there. It is there. And we are very close to accepting it. And we simply, again, have to clear up and not see it in the context of the dream, but see the dream as something that's entirely unnecessary. And just clarify it, and then we can stay with the I Am Presence continuously. Continuously. The Guru is within you. The living light is within you. And you can clear up that confusion. It is absolutely doable. And we are dedicated to bringing that about. All right. Has this been recording? Yes, it has. Very great. Everything is good. It's all good. So let us stop this recording this time. And stick with this channel. Stick with it. Stick with the videos. I try my best to bring my best, and some it's up and down, right? Because I'm going through a crisis too. Awakening from the dream, pushing it hard, it feels like a crisis. It's difficult trying to clarify this confusion. But I try to do my best, and sometimes I'll have videos that you can feel the crisis. Other times you feel like the certainty is suddenly on the ascendant, you know. So stick with it. You deserve to awaken from the dream. Absolutely, that is true. Everyone does. And those who really want to, let's get it done. Get her done. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.